Claws. It's a movie. One that I've seen. I wondered for a while whether I'd be technically allowed to cover this movie, since this channel is for, like, remakes, spin-offs, sequels, things that are based off other things. But Claws, yes, okay, it's Santa Claus. It's a myth, it's a story, it's based off another thing. It's enough for me. I want to talk about this film, so suck it up, okay? There's a lot I love about this film. There's also some stuff I did not like. But let's start with the positives. This film made me realize how much I miss stylized animation. For over a decade now, it's like all the animation studios have been in a race to make the most lifelike animation with the most detail. Listen, there's nothing wrong with hyper-realistic animation. But at the same time, I feel like studios these days are so busy asking whether they can that they don't stop to consider whether they should. Ideally, as an artist, your medium should support your message. When you consider the tone, message, and general narrative of your film, you have to ask yourself, would those elements be better conveyed through a very stylized type of animation or through a more realistic one? Stylized characters and backgrounds have character. The farther you move away from that style, the less of the artist's voice comes through until you're at basically real life. And again, that's fine. It's a creative decision. But at least with these big American animation studios, I feel like there's been less and less variety over the years. Even when you get more stylized characters these days, the backgrounds will still be as true to life as possible. Just, I missed this. I love this good shit, okay? I love that these shapes are so exaggerated. I love that this film has a geometric style and embraces the fuck out of it. Forget your hyper-realistic bushes. Our plants are gonna be perfect circles. The snow on the roof's gonna be square. The townhouses are all triangles to make them more scary. We're gonna have distinctive landscapes that serve the tone of each scene, and our characters are gonna be allowed to have wildly different proportions, even our women, because fuck you!
That got a little heated, so I'd like to take a moment to recognize how the lighting shows the divide between those characters and also shows how isolated Jesper is, where he's caught in the middle between these two sides. He's so alone. He's so alone.
Can I go off about this shape language, guys? I gotta go off about the shape language. I went to art school and our teachers would tell us that with good character design, you should be able to look at a character and know right away what kind of person they are. Claws is this giant block of a man. In character design, squares are used to denote groundedness. They're primarily used for down-to-earth, strong, stubborn, dependable characters. You look at Claws and you think, strong, intimidating, stoic, and with a hood on, mysterious. And then there's Jesper with his triangles. Triangles are the most active shape. They're typically used for more villainous characters because they're associated with untrustworthiness and the lack of stability. Triangles that point upward denote a more comical character than those that point downward, which are more used for formidable characters. Round shapes, meanwhile, are all about friendly, soft characters. You look at Jesper and you're like, wimpy, soft, untrustworthy, active. You can see how the character design pushes these two as near opposites. It's good shit. And again, there's nothing wrong with really realistic animation. I just wish there's more of this because it's really cool. So the plot's pretty straightforward. Jesper is a spoiled brat. His dad anoints him the postman of a middle of nowhere town to force him to act like a responsible adult, and he'll be cut off from the family fortune if he doesn't send off 6,000 letters in a year. Jesper recruits a hermit toymaker named Claws to help him convince the town kids to send more letters, and slowly the town becomes less of a hellhole as a result. Ain't nothing wrong with a simple story. I actually prefer simple setups myself, because generally, the more simplistic your plot, the more time you'll get to focus on your characters. And I like me some fleshed out characters! Only a couple things bothered me about the plot. I'm not sure how to feel about the fact that the Sami characters were cast as Santa's elves. Like, okay, Jesper and Claws gave you a sled, so you're gonna rebuild Claws' whole workshop for free? But the studio did their research. Pablos went to Norway and consulted with some of the Sami there, and the team portrays their culture in a really warm, positive way. And I can't think of another animated movie where a character is allowed to actually speak one of the Sami languages. So, still not super sold on the elf thing, but yay for representation! I'm also confused about this setup here.
Mr. Klaus is the coolest!
Hey, have you heard about Klaus?
His name is Klaus and he makes the best toys.
Klaus!
He's awesome!
The toys are the best!
Jesper does half the work, but Klaus gets all the credit. This scene sets up an expectation for a confrontation later in the film.
What happened?
Not a word. You just sit there. Be all magical and awesome.
What?
But this beat gets dropped like a hot potato. The film shows us that Jesper has started to really enjoy his work, and we see Klaus make an effort to make him feel more appreciated, but at the end of the day, the world at large knows the name Santa Claus, not Jesper. I mean, this movie is called Klaus, not Klaus and Jesper.
Mr. Klaus is amazing!
Yeah, he's awesome!
Yeah!
Klaus.
Whatever, I know we know Jesper has grown up, he's matured, we can assume, yeah. But like, that's a huge character revelation to decide you don't care at all about credit. So kind of weird to not let us see that moment.
Now I'm sure you've heard the rumors that I can find queer coding in anything.
Jesper morphs out of her shadow. He can't replace Lydia, obviously. Love doesn't work like that. But I do feel like he's assumed her role in Klaus's life as the person who inspires him to create, who reminds him of the wonders in life.
But then you showed up, delivering these toys, seeing the joy they bring to children. I thought I'd never feel this again. And I have you to thank for it, my friend.
They ask you how you are, you just have to say that you're fine.
Lydia, as the wind keeps playing matchmaker, trapping Jesper in Klaus's shed, passing the letter on to Klaus, and doing a big wind dance behind Jesper. And in the end, Klaus does get to be a part of an extended family, as shown here. He gets to give gifts to the children all over the world. What can I say? There's a queer reading here. A lot of people are threatened when I make comments like, oh, you can read this as gay because they, you know, think I'm forcing it onto them. No, I promise I'm not. You can have your platonic reading. That's like, I'm positive. That's what the studio wanted, was a platonic story, but you can read queerness into this, and you can see this as a love story. I'm just saying. Fuck. You know what really frustrated me about this film? Alva and Jesper's rushed relationship. She came on screen, and my mom and I were like, oop, there's the love interest. And that's fine. I really liked how she and Jesper played off each other. I was like, gee, I hope this film spends more than a second developing their relationship. Look, guys, I can ship straight pairings, okay? Anyone who's watched Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood with me has punctured eardrums from all the obnoxious squealing I do every time Roy and Risa are on screen together.
Oh my god, it's so soft! Look at his face! Oh god, they're looking at each other!
But you know why I ship them? Few people stop to question why the guy gets the girl at the end of the story, even when the two characters don't have, like, any chemistry. Because we've been trained from a very young age to look at a girl and a guy and say, they're in love!
He was a boy, she was a girl, can I make it any more obvious?
Screenwriters know this, and they use it as an excuse to be lazy with their character writing. Why put in the effort to develop a believable bond between two characters when you can just flip through their relationship milestones like a Rolodex and the audience will still eat it up? Everyone expects them to get together by the end anyway. It's so unbalanced. We're in this weird place right now where audiences have been trained to accept a girl-guy romance between two very different people without a lot of development, but they still have to be won over to believe a friendship of the same nature. So friendships will often get a lot more screen time than romantic relationships, which confuses me as an ace person. You know, I'm gonna believe that the friendship more, you spent more time, I don't know what to tell you. In films like Claws, this means you'll spend the entire film watching Claws and Jesper get closer, and then you'll be expected to buy Jesper and Alva's relationship with very little lead up. It's such a strange mismatch to me. Now, please understand that this isn't me saying, why no guy get with guy? Bad film because not gay.
Queerbaiting.
It's me being like, I wish screenwriters wouldn't expect me to buy a close relationship that has, like, so little development. I almost feel talked down to when this happens. I ain't stupid, guys. You hand me a wad of dough, and I'm not gonna call it a finished pie. Believable relationships require screen time to develop, and Jesper and Alva didn't get that. I'm like, did we really need this? Kiss, kiss, have two children, one boy, one girl. If it was gonna be so unbelievable, why even bother? I do not like this. No, sir. Not my favorite. No, thank you. I'll pass.
Good day, sir!
Claus's score is beautiful and also kinda generic, which I think sucks considering the unique nature of the visuals here. You kinda want the background music to match up, right? I mean, with a film set in Scandinavia like this, I'd hoped the creative team would draw inspiration from the music of that region. Like, think of it this way. What would the How to Train Your Dragon soundtrack be like without the penny whistle, or the fiddle, or the bagpipes? What would the Moana soundtrack be like without the taik drums and the Polynesian vocals? The music from these films really works in tandem with the visuals to sell you on the setting, creating a much more immersive, memorable experience. If you swapped Kung Fu Panda music with Moana music, you'd notice. But Claus has no regional identity or even, like, a distinct sound. Finding Nemo doesn't borrow from any specific region, but it still has a very distinctive soundtrack. This music from Claus could belong to any other film. I feel like the closest we get to a unique sound is with Lydia's theme.
Arms when she came to me, and then Kristoff. Little ugly Kristoff.
And then this fucking song! Claus has the potential to be a timeless film, just like the Santa Claus myth is timeless, but it grounds itself in this distinctly 2010 song. Why? Why would you do this? It's so out of place with the setting. Like, I know Spirit used, like, that 2000s, like, song sound, like, like, that kind of voice. But at least that was consistent. We got several songs across that movie. So, yeah, it didn't really match the setting, but it was still unique to the film, and it created an identity for that film. But this song, there's no motif here. It just pops out of nowhere. Why? I'm sorry I'm going off on this, but this distracted the hell out of me. Like, if not for this song, I wouldn't have even made a music section of this video, but this one track crossed the line for me. It bothered me so much that I was like, yeah, okay, you know what, fine. I'm gonna talk about the fucking music. You have gone from generic to annoying. I should probably figure out how to end this review. So maybe you've noticed all my asides and how harsh I've been on this film, and you're like, why, Rab? Why you gotta be so mean to this amazing film? Well, this all reminds me of a time when I went to my picture and word class with this illustration of a girl and a mongoose in a field of umbrella plants. And I was able to get the details on those plants and the background turned out really nice, but the girl looked totally whack. And you know what my teacher's reaction was during critique? She looked at my piece and she said, "How dare you?" Literally, "How dare you?" Like she was actually mad at me. She was like, "Why did you do this? You have such a beautiful background, and then this girl looks awful." And I went home like, "Why, Judy? Why couldn't you have just been like, hey, your human anatomy still needs work. This one's cartoony style really clashes with the background. Why'd you have to be like, how dare you?" But you know what? Now I get it. If I had turned in a piece that was just mediocre all the way through, my teacher wouldn't have gotten riled up. But because I did really well in one area of the piece, more was expected of me. And so when I didn't meet that bar, there was real frustration. How dare I squander my piece's potential, dammit! That's how I feel about Claus. I wouldn't be going on these tangents about character relationships and music if I didn't feel that strongly about Claus's potential as a film. The parts of Claus that succeed really succeed. I love the animation so much, and Claus and Jesper's dynamic so much, and there are moments when the emotions of the film are so strong. I want the rest of this film to match that level of quality. That's where my frustration comes from. Claus's spectacular animation in particular sets up a high fucking bar for the rest of the film, and I don't feel like that expectation was always met. I do absolutely recommend this film regardless. I mean, look at the visuals. I got some good laughs out of this film as well.
Look, too bad about the fence. Rats. Oh well. What are you gonna do? What's happening right now?
But I'm sure the studio has learned a ton from this experience, and the only way we'll get to see another film from them is if we support this one. So, regardless of my gripes with the film, grab some popcorn and enjoy some fucking amazing animation. And maybe turn down your sound when Invisible comes on.